successful administration of the military power that they are providing to their allies in the country? What's the end state that they think is reasonable to achieve from sponsoring this proxy war?
In Syria.
In Syria, yes.
Yeah. I mean, I think in the Turkish case, the refrain, you know, for a very long time now, is an anti-Assad refrain. So anyone but Assad. Now, who is Turkey backing in an effort to get rid of Assad? That's something that is much less clear. I think both in terms of press coverage. So if you look at anti-regime press coverage in Turkey, they'll say that the Turks are directly supporting ISIS, actually. you'll see if you read pro-regime press coverage, the idea is they're supporting more quote-unquote moderate, and how moderate is up for debate, groups. And these groups, I think, they run the gamut, right? At some point, these were groups like Nusra Front. Now they've shifted. And so I don't know that Turkey has an end game in mind, except for an end game that is not a feasible end game, which is a Syria without Assad.
I'm going to follow up. There seems to be some strategic logic to their behavior, at least that's been attributed to their behavior. Even in your talk, you attributed some strategic logic to their behavior, right? You don't have to be a genius to imagine that both scenarios of a Syria without Assad are a Syria in which either there's an extended war, and in that extended war, the Kurds might actually do well, right? Or the strongest groups are going to take over the state, and the strongest groups are either one set of Islamist groups or the other. It's either the coalition around Nusra or the coalition around ISIL. Within Turkey, is this outcome discussed, or is it, in other words, is there a kind of a conspiracy of silence on what the end game looks like, and there's just a kind of a publicly discussed miracle of Assad disappearing, and then something good will follow?
I think that there certainly isn't. You're not going to read the press coverage in which people talk about an end game and ISIS winning in an end game and that being a positive outcome in any way, shape, or form. But there's a paper mache the refrain you hear is moderate Syrian opposition, time and time again.
But these people have no name.
Not really in the Turkish press.
Yeah, the name is the moderate Syrian.
The name is the moderate Syrian.
It's an empty setup with a name. Okay.
Yeah.
Searching for
Gaddafi.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Moderate, sorry. I think Saudi Arabia is deeply conflicted and deeply stuck in Syria, like almost every other international player, where there's no good outcomes now. I think initially Saudi Arabia's involvement and engagement in Syria was through the singular lens of an anti-Assad stance, as an anti-Shia, anti-Iran. We are going to dislodge one of the spheres of Iranian influence in our region. This President Assad and the, but also I think moved by the attacks of the Syrian government, particularly when it became mass attacks using bombardment against a Sunni population. I think that also played a role. The dilemma for them was, though, to be promoting and supporting what was initially a democracy movement against a dictatorship. And there are many of those who believe that, in fact, Saudi Arabia never wanted the democratic opposition in Syria to succeed, because then they would have another situation, for example, like the Muslim Brotherhood's successful election victory, peaceful transition in Egypt, where their own illegitimacy, was further exposed. And there are, as a result, they were stuck in a situation where they didn't really want either side to win, and it became let's try to gain influence over certain factions, like particular Islamist groups, who we will control as puppeteers, because we're giving them money and we're giving them arms, you know, indirectly, privately, through private channels, and, you know, see if that outcome might be better. Of course, it deteriorated into absolute chaos. And so, you know, I think officially the Saudi government will say that they have never specifically armed or funded groups, but I think that has been belied by various experts and reveals. The outcome now, I mean, I think they're certainly part of the international group that is negotiating the peace process, and the ceasefire that was recently negotiated. They agreed to be at that table. They finally agreed that Iran should be at that table. So I think at some level there's an understanding that, you know, the conflict needs to end, the fighting needs to end. But I don't think they thought through, or any of us has thought through, well, what's the outcome we want? How do we get out of this?
Okay. People should start gravitating towards the mic, and I'll ask another question or two, unless people are ready to start. Or are there people ready? So I think there are. So let's, since you volunteered, you get the first question.
Thank you very much for the panel. A question about Saudi Arabia. You mentioned very quickly in the beginning of your talk that you have some information about personalities inside. So can you shed some light into the decision-making process? Who's taking decisions? Who's making, especially the war in Yemen? And related to that, question about the price of oil and what kind of prospects does this have in decision-making processes?
In terms of the internal dynamics of Saudi Arabia, you know, it's really no different than the sort of gossip that my mom and my aunts engage in when they talk about, you know, what this person said and did, and what person said and did, except you're doing it on a national level. So what we know and hear is really gossip from elites about what's going on. So I'm just caveating what I'm saying with that, and that's because there's a completely opaque system of government, no transparency. There's not public hearings and commissions and, you know, debates in the Shura Council about our policy in Yemen and the decision to go to war in Yemen. So there's very little in the public record where you can cite, well, this official said that or that official said that. Many people attribute it to the new crown prince, the son of the king, who is both minister of defense and minister of economy, who is not even 30 years old, and from what we're told is not, maybe attended a year of college, but doesn't have a college degree, showing his bona fides as a loved leader in the country, being groomed to be the next king by winning a war. And the Saudi, the scuttlebutt is that they thought it would be an easy war. They would easily defeat the Houthis, just like we were going to easily dislodge ISIS from Mosul. And it was going to be over in a matter of months, and he would be a great war hero, reestablishing President Hadi in Yemen. And that's how it was supposed to go. But that's not how it's gone. It's gone very badly. And I don't think anyone can say that President Hadi is anywhere near to restoring his presidency in the country. And the Saudis are sinking a lot of money, and they're actually losing some personnel, and it's coming to hit them with shelling that does reach across the border of Saudi Arabia. So it's also turned into now, apparently, inside Saudi Arabia, quite an unpopular war with, again, the, you know, gossip being that many of the princes, the ruling elites, are very unhappy, and supposedly there have been a number of inside mini coup attempts or, you know, talk about getting rid of the crown prince. Minister of Defense, Minister of Economy, because not only do you have this disastrous war in Yemen, which is also, you know, opening them up to quite a bit of international criticism, but also the price of oil, meaning there's less petrodollar to buy peace with. On the economic front, I mean, if you're an economist, you might know, I've heard very starkly, you know, conflicting narratives. One is, it's trouble in Saudi Arabia, there are going to be layoffs from the public sector, their reserves have plummeted, they can't afford to sustain the social welfare peace plan that they have in the country. You know, this is a very, very big problem. There are others who say, no way, they have the deepest reserves of any country in the world. We don't even know what their oil reserves are. They have nothing to worry about. You know, this is they have enough cash to keep things flowing for another 20 or 30 years. Again, very little transparency, very sort of, they put out some numbers on their sort of national fund investments and so forth, but it's all indirect measurements when you try to come up with a number. So I don't know about the economy.
Yeah, maybe just one point on the economy. I think that we don't know a lot about the depth of the reserves and Saudi's ability to kind of withstand the drain on its resources in terms of a drop in oil prices. But one thing that you can look at, and we do see in the last year, is Saudi financing going abroad elsewhere. And despite the drop in oil prices, that does not seem to have dried up. So if that's not drying up, the idea that the Saudis are in trouble at home and still funding things to the same extent that they do abroad, I think calls into question, you know, they might be willing to withstand some of these pressures for a lot longer than you'd think.
You're speaking of the funding of religious and educational institutions?
Religious and educational institutions, foreign direct investment, all sorts of balance of payment type transfers.
This gentleman.
Yeah, so I know you said one question, so I'll try to stick to that as best as possible. But yeah, you guys kind of read my mind by opening up the economic sides of the story. But is it possible that Syria is both for the Saudis and for the Iranians a land-based petro-economic route into Western Europe versus something, shall we say, like natural gas? Is it possible that Syria is basically, for the Iranians, a proxy to funnel natural gas into the Mediterranean, and likewise for the Saudi Arabians, a possible avenue into Western Europe for natural gas or other petro resources?
I've never heard the argument made. Doesn't mean somebody hasn't made it, but I've never heard the argument made.
Yeah, that's not an argument that I've heard either. You hear a lot about natural gas pipelines between Russia and Turkey heading into the European Union, but not via Syria. That's not an argument that I've heard.
Roger.
Yeah, my question picks up on Professor Posen about the future end state here. So even if we have a ceasefire, some sort of a solution in Syria, short of partition, the Kurds there are likely to have a very highly autonomous situation. And would this mean that the Turks, would they tolerate that, or are we in a long-term Turkey just messing up with the Kurds in Syria for a long state? And relatedly, given Erdogan's overtures to the KDP and Barzani's, I mean, he went dedicated the airport in Erbil, the ability of Turks to do divide and rule politics among the Iraqi Kurds.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a little bit curious because if you would have said, you know, when the KRG started to gain some semblance of independence, there was a lot of buzz in the press that the Turks were never going to tolerate that, that the Turks were never going to be okay with an autonomous Kurdish unit in the northern part of the Iraqi state. And as soon as those commercial ties opened up, and as soon as the Turks saw that Barzani was going to be okay with dealing with Turks, they flipped. And not only did they flip, but they flipped completely to the point that they're now working together with Barzani to divide Kurdish groups. So, you know, my sense is that in the short term now, that said though, the Syrian Kurds, the PKK is what is the sticking point here. And to the extent, you know, that the Syrian Kurds have close ties militarily, both with KJK and with the PKK, that's going to be a more difficult pill for the Turks to swallow. But again, you know, I've never ceased to be surprised. Especially this regime has had a very interesting track record of building coalitions with groups, and then when they no longer find those groups to be useful, just trashing them. So they did this with the Gulenists, they did this with the domestic Kurds, what they did with basically all of the show trials with Ergenekon and whatnot. So they seem to be completely okay in playing power politics. Yesterday's enemy is tomorrow's friend. I could see them coming around eventually if it was somehow in their strategic interest. But at this point in time, given the domestic unrest in the Southeast, I don't think that it is.
So their interest in the prospects for the Kurds in Syria, they
connect directly to their own courage and service.
Oh,